let's look at using DxO PhotoLab 7 to edit infrared photography. When I last looked at version 4 of PhotoLab, it was missing some key features. Has version 7 addressed these? How does PhotoLab compare to other raw editors for editing infrared photography? Let's dive in. DxO PhotoLab is available for macOS and Windows. It offers a 30-day free trial. It has a one-time purchase only or upgrades for existing users, no subscriptions. It comes in two editions, Essential and Elite, and there are some important differences between these editions that we'll cover. DxO also offers a variety of plugins, as well as the Knit Collection. Over on the left-hand side, I see two options, Photo Library, where I can browse and manage my images, and then Customize, which I can use to actually develop an image. Let's set a white balance. So if I come over here to the right-hand side, I can see a number of options available, a number of these modules. These tabs at the top allow me to jump between different groupings of modules. The color balance is in the color tab, the second tab, and I can come down to raw white balance. I enable a module with this little toggle here, and I turn it on. I want to set a custom white balance. So I'll use the picker, and I will click on the clouds in this image to set a white balance. So that gives me a pretty good white balance. We have a color temperature of 2125. So the range that DxO supports is from 2000 to 50,000. And so I can tweak that, or I can set a white balance with the picker. If you're not able to set a good white balance with the picker, you have an additional option available because DxO supports DCP profiles. So the way that I adjust those is in the color and black and white rendering section. So if I come into that section and enable it and I open it up, I have options for different types of generic rendering, which would give me the built-in camera profile for my Fujifilm X-T20 or a variety of other DxO profiles, similar to what you would see in Lightroom or other editors. I can also select a DCP profile, and this would allow me to import a DCP file, and this could be used to adjust the color temperature if you can't get the temperature low enough. And so in this case, I've imported a color temperature profile from the infrared profile pack, and you can download the infrared profile pack for free to get profiles that can be used here in PhotoLab. I've currently set up to use the negative 100 profile, and once I've got that picked, I can then double check my white balance. A lot of times, DxO will give you a good white balance, but if you find that you're not able to get one directly, you can use a DCP file to get a good white balance. Solid performance from DxO PhotoLab on white balancing. For this image, let me go back over to the Light tab, and I could increase the exposure a little bit. I could also come into the Selective Tones, and I could bring up the Midtones and the Shadows a little bit to bring out some of that detail here in the image. Let's talk about swapping colors. In general, there are three methods that we would use to swap colors: a channel mixer, a invert, or a hue shift. And let's talk about each of those in DxO PhotoLab. So first of all, the channel mixer. This one is a little confusing in DxO because technically there is a channel mixer, but there isn't a channel mixer. So if I come into the color section and I scroll down to the bottom, you'll see a section called channel mixer, which I can enable and then make some adjustments. However, this is not the type of channel mixer that you would expect from Photoshop, where you are actually looking at the red, green, and blues and then using them to swap. This channel mixer is more like the black and white adjustment layer in Photoshop or the B&W panel in Lightroom, where you are using individual colors to brighten or darken tones for a monochrome conversion. In DxO, it's called a channel mixer. For our purposes, it's not really a channel mixer, so no channel mixer available in DxO for the purposes of color swapping. If you want to do a monochrome conversion, you can use the channel mixer panel to actually adjust those tones, although you'll get better results in the HSL panel if you're doing that in infrared. The next option is invert. Invert requires layers. There are no layers, so strike two on color swapping. This takes us to the third option that we have, which is the hue shift. Now, the hue shift is something that, as you can see here with the HSL panel, we do have covered. So let's go into HSL. There are a number of channels that are available here across the top. I want to make sure I'm selecting the white channel, which is essentially the global channel that affects all colors. Now that I'm here, I can grab this pin on the outside of the color wheel, and I can spin it around all the way to the other side. Now, I don't have any numbers here to give me an exact value of what's actually 180 degrees, but that's okay. Probably better to just eyeball the image and say, oh, what kind of colors do I want? What sky color do I want? Maybe a little bit more of a baby blue or teal, or do I want more of a purple sky? And then, of course, you could address the foliage through this color as well. But let me just do kind of a flat adjustment, because I can now adjust individual channels to refine the colors separately from the sky and the foliage. And the way that I do that is by grabbing this hue picker. And if I grab the hue picker and then click the sky, you'll see that over on the right-hand side, I now have the blue channel selected, and this defines a range of the blue channel, and I can grab the pin and make adjustments to the color that only affects the blues. So I'm only affecting the sky. I'm not affecting the color of the foliage, so I can refine the hue color of the sky. I can do the same thing with the foliage. Let me grab the picker again, and I will select the grass here. This shows me the orange channel up here, the orange channel on the color wheel, and now I can drag to make adjustments to the color. And in addition to changing the hue, of course, I could also change the saturation. I could increase the saturation, or I could adjust the luminance to make changes to both the foliage and the sky individually. So the HSL panel is very nice because not only does it allow me to do a color swap, but it allows me to refine the colors for the sky and the foliage. In addition to those three standard ways of swapping colors, there's actually a fourth way within DxO PhotoLab that leverages those other three, and that's by using LUTs. This is only available in the Elite Edition, but if we go into the LUT grading panel up here, LUT grading, and let me turn off HSL first. So if I go into LUT grading, now I can look at various types of rendering. There's a number of default renderings that are included, some default LUTs, but I have imported a LUT from the free LUTs that I have available for download on my website. And in this case, I've loaded a red-blue color swap, which is a channel mixer. So by using these LUTs, you have the ability to do all three of those styles, the channel mixer, invert, and hue, by importing them from a LUT. And so once I have the LUT in place, now I've got my color swap. Now, something to be aware of with the LUTs, you can define a color space specifically for a LUT. The default is sRGB, but that is actually a color space with the smallest gambit, the least amount of colors. And so you might want to change this to a color space with a larger number of colors. That'll affect the look of the image. So for example, display P3, which is a good choice if you have a monitor that supports 100% of the colors in display P3. You also have Adobe RGB, which is a very solid choice. Again, a similar gamut of colors to display P3, a very popular color space. And then you also have Rec 2020. You have Profoto RGB, which is the color space with the largest gamut. This will give you the most colors to be able to examine your image. It's important that you select the color space that has a large number of colors, and then later on you can still export your image in sRGB for JPEG, but this gives you the most flexibility for editing. So be sure to adjust from the default sRGB to one of the other color spaces that have more colors. Let's talk a little bit about contrast for an image. So there's a variety of ways that you can add contrast in DxO. Let's go over to the light panel, and the first thing we'll do is go down to contrast, and you'll see we have options here for both contrast and micro contrast. The micro contrast will give you more detail in some of these edges, so this is a really nice tool to add contrast to your image. The next option is the DxO Clearview Plus, which is a fancy way of saying dehaze. By default, it's 50, which is very intense, so I might turn this down to something in the neighborhood of 20 or so to get a little bit of extra punch in my image through this dehaze style Clearview Plus, but not too much. Too much of this is going to be a bit over the top. So a little bit here. The other option that we have for adding contrast is the tone curve. So if I enable the tone curve, now I could go ahead and create a three-point curve I could increase the highlights, decrease the shadows, or I could make individual adjustments to different points of the image. So that's a great option as well. There's also a gamma adjustment here. So I could overall adjust the gamma of the image, and you can see that shifts the curve up and down, as well as impacting the brightness of the image. There's a couple features that I wish were added to the tone curve. One of them is a picker, be able to pick a tone on the screen, which puts a dot on the tone curve. That feature doesn't exist. Also, it would be nice to have some presets so that I didn't have to go in and make my own curve every time that I was editing an image. So a couple features that would be nice to see added to DxO in the tone curve. Let's talk about a couple features that are only available in the Elite Edition. So if I go into the Detail tab, you will see the denoising technologies. Let me turn that on. High quality is available in the Essential version of DxO PhotoLab, but if you want to use any of the other options, Prime, Deep Prime, or Deep Prime XD, which have more advanced options for reducing noise, then you would need the Elite version. I don't tend to find that I have a lot of noise problems when I'm shooting infrared because I'm shooting during the day, but if you find yourself in a scenario where you have a lot of noise, be aware that you'll need the Elite version in order to use these features. Another feature that requires the Elite version, if I go into the far right panel, which is local adjustments, I can get into all of the local adjustments that are available. So many of the things that you would see in other programs like radial gradients, linear gradients, brushes, etc. One of the features here, this luminosity masking, is only available with the film pack, an add-on. And then if I go down to the HSL panel that's available here, the one we saw that we made the global adjustment for, this is actually only available in the Elite version of DxO PhotoLab. So be aware of those things if you want to use these tools as a local adjustment. What we did earlier was a global adjustment that affected the whole screen. Let's recap. Can DxO PhotoLab edit infrared images? Yes. It has solid white balance with support for DCP files. You can swap colors via a hue shift. There's also support for LUTs in the Elite Edition. DxO PhotoLab has a clean and easy-to-use interface. There are two editions of PhotoLab, Essential and Elite. There are also multiple add-ons available, including the Nick Collection, Film Pack, Pure Raw, and Viewpoint, all for an additional cost. Some key features are only available in the Elite Edition. DCP file support, LUTs, HSL in local adjustments, Fujifilm X-Trans support, DxO Clearview Plus, and more. If you're interested in PhotoLab, I recommend the Elite version. A few features such as luminosity masks and split toning are only available with the addition of DxO Film Pack. The lower cost Essential Edition costs less, but misses the mark if you use Fujifilm cameras or want to use LUTs for color swapping. If cost is your primary motivator, check out Darktable, Raw Therapy, or On One Photo Raw. PhotoLab and all of the add-ons are each offered as a one-time purchase with no subscription. If avoiding a subscription is your primary motivator, DxO PhotoLab addresses that. If you use masking, then Lightroom has more masking features. If you use tablets for photo editing, then Lightroom, On One Photo Raw, or Pixelmator may be better suited for you. Otherwise, DxO PhotoLab is a solid choice for editing infrared images. Is it the right editor for you? Be sure to give the 30-day trial a spin. Have you used DxO PhotoLab for infrared editing? What do you like or dislike about it? Let us know in the comments. If you'd like to learn more about infrared photography, sign up for my newsletter, Infrared Insights. I'll keep you informed about the latest videos, software, guides, and equipment for infrared photography. A link is in the description. If you find these videos helpful on your infrared photography journey, like, subscribe, or comment. Hope you enjoyed. Thanks.